La Scozia, con i suoi tipici loch, gli innumerevoli laghetti che costellano l'ampia e caratteristica regione posta al nord della Gran Bretagna, è luogo di antiche tradizioni pastorali e guerriere. Molto attaccati alle loro radici, di rado gli scozzesi compiono trasferte o realizzano viaggi. Fa eccezione in questi giorni nel nostro paese la visita di uno dei figli più illustri della Scozia, il poeta e letterato Hamish Henderson.
Hamish Henderson.
Hamish war eine komplexe Person. Er war ein Internationalist. Er war vom Krieg geprägt. Er war Antifaschist. Er war Anti-Apartheid-Kämpfer.
Col grado di capitano, Hamish Henderson sbarcò in Sicilia nel luglio del 43, dopo aver partecipato in prima linea all'avanzata britannica nell'Africa settentrionale, ad El Alamein. Come ufficiale di collegamento con le forze della nostra resistenza, Henderson risiedeva in tale veste la cattura del maresciallo Graziani.
I mean, he was, you know, he was a force of nature, my dad. You know, he had this way, in a sense, he did feel that he kind of almost could influence things.
And I'm not keen to catch. I'm keen to man horse to legend. I guess Jalab a hacking should the gunny more cool art. I guess stuck a grow paint alive, not ramen alive.
Gatam vai mar seijar, mar barst, mar teacher, mar scholar. Carriage gilas gilas.
I first met Hamish Henderson at 5 to midnight on May Day 1967 in the small fishing village of Padstow in Cornwall, where they have a great fertility rite, a May Day celebration, full of joy of the kind that Hamish loved. And we talked for 3 hours, and my life was changed by that day.
Under the earth I go, on the oak leaf I stand. I ride on the filly that never was foaled, and I carry the dead in my hand. There's method in my magic.
There are many dead in the British desert who lie uneasy among the scrub in this landscape of half-wit, stunted ill will. For the dead land is insatiate and necropolis. The sand is blowing about still. Coming back to the battlefields of North Africa and Sicily has almost been for me like coming back from the dead myself. It's impossible for me to express my feelings. Although I still think, as I thought then, that we were right to fight that war and to destroy fascism with all the means in our power. Many who, for various reasons or for mere unanswerable compulsion, came here and fought among the clutching gravestones, shivered and sweated, cried out, suffered thirst, was stoically silent, cursed the spittering machine guns, were homesick for Europe, and fast embedded in quicksand of Africa, agonized and died, and sleep now, sleep here, the sleep of the dust.
Caro Aeson am a Uchka War Ijo. Ach, Haye Shimbridge, Olha Shimbridge, a Malam of the Hoshi and Goku. I was with Ghanan Keremel, just the Ghanan Itish, Jungsucher. I was not a Yanishin, Munjer, Nirim, Korodahan and Eke, by Aeson Erkul Loinachen, I was a Kisnachu, Priest and Ish Hockey.
Pretty much a law unto himself in the intelligence corps, and I'm sure they kind of encouraged that maverick side because he seemed to get really good information out of the people he was interrogating.
Hamish interrogated and treated his prisoners of war basically extremely well, thousands of them.
Occasionally, he would actually collect from them versions of Lily Marlene and such like, which were obviously not difficult to find at that time, and other German songs. So, and when there again, he always fell into this role of collecting, you know, which clearly, and he was very good. I mean, even with the German, he could make them talk or even sing, possibly, you know.
When I was a student at Cambridge, I was deeply interested in German literature, and particularly in the poetry and prose of Heinrich Heine, who was, of course, a very unpopular character in Nazi Germany at that time because he was a Jew. The contrast between Goethe's Weimar, which I was reading about at Cambridge, and the reality of Hitler's Germany when I saw it on holiday trips was about as brutal a contrast as could be imagined.
Hat Hitler gesehen bei einer Parade, er war Antifaschist natürlich und er hat sich mit diesem, ja, mit dieser großen Frage des 20. Jahrhunderts, wie ein Volk, das Goethe, Schiller, Hölderlin, Rilke und so weiter hervorbringen konnte, eben in diese Barbarei des Nazismus verfallen konnte.
The atmosphere of Germany was not particularly nice, you know, with the Nazi regime and all that. And I think it sort of left a permanent kind of, how can I put it, you know, black mark against Germany. And he sort of kind of almost felt he shouldn't trust the Germans, you know. And although strange to see, then and he ends up marrying a German, you know.
I can talk about hockey. That Hamish is as on the way, travel a clown, you look, and hurt as a yarra much go brechting.
He saw firsthand what was going on and the threat that the Jews were under. It was his greater humanitarian ideals which kind of overrode his pacifist ones, that he felt that this was something that was kind of bigger than just his principles about fighting. After El Alamein, Hamish went across the Mediterranean to Sicily, pursuing the Germans.
I remember someone telling me a marvelous story when they were landing on the beach in Sicily. He was greeted by an officer coming down on a white horse and making it rear up in front of the troops and shouting, "No Germans for 10 miles, come on, boys." This was Hamish.
Standing at the side of the road, I saw two of the least likely Sicilians you can imagine. So I said, "Sind Sie Deutsche?" Said, "Jawohl." I asked him his name, his rank, and his number, which he gave, also his unit, which he was not really entitled to do. His companion at first demurred when I asked him the same questions, but a moment or two later, he cut the cackle and announced that he was Major Günther, the same man that had actually been commanding the paratroops at Francoforte. So I turned the jeep round and decided to take this prisoner, who was quite an important prisoner,
back to Core HQ. And I brought him back down this road, delivered him to Core, and said cheerio.
He had his own villa near Messina in the north of Sicily. And as he said, he gave some of the best dinner parties in the Highland Division. And this villa had a very good wine cellar, which Hamish would know how to raid, I'm quite sure.
And it was there that he completed his great song, Farewell, Ye Banks of Sicily, or the 51st Highland Division's Farewell to Sicily.
And as they played, words came into my head at that moment.
There's nae him can smoor the wiles, ye puir bloody bastard are weary. Then doon the stair and line the waterside, which your turn the ferries are wo'. Then doon the stair and line the waterside, or the brech chalmers are eerie. The drummy is polished.
An dem Tag auf dem Marktplatz hörte eine Dudelsack-Melodie, eine schottische Dudelsack-Melodie, und hat dazu relativ spontan ein Lied geschrieben über den Abschied, den bittersüßen Abschied. Weil auf der einen Seite ist ihnen den Soldaten Sizilien ins Herz gewachsen und jetzt ging es weiter in den Krieg mit ungewisser Aussicht im Marsch auf Rom. Und er hat diese Atmosphäre des Abschieds in The Farewell to Sicily geschildert.
Grandmother, like many old ladies of her generation, was a staunch, nostalgic Jacobite. She had a prodigious, retentive memory for songs, ballads, recitations, all that sort of thing. She wasn't really a very good singer, if I've got to tell the truth. In fact, some have said she had a voice rather like a corncrake. On the other hand, she was an eloquent reciter.
Family was hugely important to him. And I mean, he did talk about his mum and his granny, and they were obviously huge, really important figures in his life. And to me, you know, I think that's quite understandable when you think about, you know, what his life had been like up to then.
Well, Hamish was born in Blairgowrie in East Perthshire in 1919 on the 11th of November, exactly 1 year after the armistice. He was then, as an illegitimate boy, somewhat hounded out of the town up to Glenshee.
Ah, there's nobody here.
Where his mother brought him up in a little Highland community. And Hamish felt a very strong bond to Gaelic culture.
The windows bolted and barred from which I saw the west. I can't help thinking of Sorley MacLean's beautiful poem, Hallig, coming back to this cottage in which I spent my childhood.
Now the Hachemish in Toshach, we had a creochinator, Dujuk Kui, Agus Kalamahua, by Agus Hyplionish and Shechat, Man the Yin Shaker and the Shurach Festival. The Rukulay and the Black Guy, the Blair Gowrie and the Bill, Nafashke, you.
Bega brinrum gyma trich iddo fa fa sŵas ond o siroc fiarst. Fa siroc fiarst o am ys o'ch dlwga.
Fa galig egin hei achga agus fa oren galig co yw.
harogarig ec hi, mis i ddim yn sagrad, ach, dwi'n hoffi chi'n twachgo, mae fes yn heno. Ach, fe'n achos taich gan y gael ec hi yw.
Spring quickens in the she water and fishing. Time on Forbes Mountain, time heaps stone on stone. The speech and silence of Christ's world is Gaelic, and youth on age, the tree climbs from the bone. That's part of a poem I wrote called Scottish Childhood. More silence than speech as far as the Gaelic is concerned, maybe, for it died out in the early years of the century in this glen. But all the place names are Gaelic, and everyone here, you don't need to talk more than a few minutes to find that there is this presence of Gaelic which lives behind in the memory of all the people who were natives of the glen.
Hamish's primary influence was his mother and her singing and reciting poetry to him when he was just a wee lad influenced him greatly.
Hamish's mother, Janet Henderson, was born in 1880. In 1928, Hamish moved with his mother to Somerset, where she had a job as a housekeeper.
Fi a brin mae ein y fath ag yma trig. Ach a fi a brin mae ein y fath. Ach fi a hwn i brin mae ein y fath ag ys gosht sy fa ga gyn fa sy y fath ag ys a hen cho og. Ag ys eisiau cho og cwtioch.
His mother unfortunately died when he was only 12, you know, and so he was basically an orphan because there was nobody. He didn't have a father, so to speak.
Brighton, last night to the flicks. And now I'm sitting in a dressing gown on a rumpled, unmade bed. There's a trunk in the room and plates, early morning sunshine, and Mrs. O'Byrne saying, my mother's dead.
Dwi'n hoffi chorig, yn eisiau hadw gael yn lach o ddiw mae yw'n sy'n rhywm sy'n nari dwi'n eil o'ch hoffa ty sanio go. Fa fe hec as y diog sy'n gyma crwy, gyma dref ec yw'n lawn. Agus fe ge hyn, a mis mewn i'ch o'r cwmor, ddim yn dod o'r ffalwch, hyn eisiau stoch o'ch ti'n y bar.
I think that the fact that Hamish had to spend some of his childhood in an orphanage when he was a day boy at Dulwich College, it must have had profound effects on him. And he always regarded his mother as a tower of strength. He received scholarships at Dulwich and at Cambridge, but how his finances would have been seen to, I have no idea. I don't think that a scholarship would have covered all these living expenses.
Ik ander va dunye horse in fekin mer gunye kemasura check gefütige vi ho Nigel gen hufu a tokel huere well huere tokel an anun doy doctor skoltelich is drogen in horse a huere tokel stock up for rock drogen de dolish och vera rakel na unren ach sech vi granil gan hugu sonne be kur er reik mig gulig gan hugu agus gashin trof tro at de behe va mis ekir chira eren hugu vor so roi bio
Hamish è arrivato in Italia dal Nord Africa, è sbarcato in Sicilia. Dopo la Sicilia è andato in Calabria, in Napoli, Anzio, poi a Roma, poi ha continuato per Firenze fino a Bologna, dove ha preso in consegna, tra l'altro, il maresciallo Graziani verso la fine della guerra.
Hamish worked with Marshal Graziani, who was the leader of the Italian troops in Rome, to draft his capitulation. It was the message to the troops to say, give up your arms. If you carry on fighting, it'll be regarded as a criminal activity. And this was all with Hamish's help that this capitulation was drafted. So he was very instrumental in that major stage in the war.
Hamish è stato maestro di cerimonia alla liberazione di Roma. E entrò con le truppe scozzesi, con alla testa l'Anzio Pipe Band, questa formazione di Pipers che lui aveva riunito, prendendo i Pipers dai vari reggimenti scozzesi, c'erano Blackwatch, Seaforth e altri, Gordon, mi ricordo. Entrarono il 5 di giugno dall'Appia, entrarono marciando. E ricordo che lui disse che si prepararono per sfilare con lui alla testa dal Colosseo a Piazza Venezia, la via imperiale che Mussolini aveva pensato di far sfilare le sue truppe. Invece arrivarono i Pipers e la gente era festante, gli andava incontro, gli abbracciava e loro suonavano per 2 giorni. Loro non hanno fatto altro che suonare a Piazza Venezia, alla Via del Corso. Sono andati dal Papa il giorno dopo, al Vaticano.
All'origine della sua vita e della sua missione nel mondo non è stata...
Avanti popolo, alla riscossa, bandiera rossa, bandiera rossa. Avanti popolo, alla riscossa, bandiera rossa, la trionferà.
Bandiera rossa, la trionferà. Bandiera rossa, la trionferà. Bandiera rossa, la trionferà. E vive il comunismo e la libertà.
Bandiera rossa è una delle canzoni che Hamish durante la liberazione di Roma cantava spesso con i partigiani comunisti romani.
Hamish was a sort of chief liaison officer with the Italian partisans, the resistance fighters for Italy.
They spoke to something in his character. They were independent freebooters, men of learning, courage, action, and in Italy, of course, they formed a fifth column, fighting the Germans.
He became very close to them. They were communists to a man, basically, and Hamish's political sympathies were very much with them too. There's that great photograph of Hamish. They're all making the communist salute, and in full uniform. Just sums Hamish up. He was sincere and meant it in every direction. He wasn't being duplicitous. That was just him.
Diana was a woman working for Radio Rome at the time the Allied troops entered Rome. And she drew one small, very beautiful portrait of Hamish in which she captures the youthful, satyr-like joy of this man who spoke to her as a poet and a singer. He might have married her, but he realized that his responsibility was not really to his own short-term happiness with a woman, but to Scotland and to a bigger future and to his poetry.
One evening, breaking a jeep journey at Capuzzo, I noticed a soldier as he entered the cemetery and stood looking at the grave of a fallen enemy. Then I understood the meaning of the hard word pietas, a word unfamiliar to the newsreel commentator, as well as to the pimp, the informer, and the traitor. His thought was like this. Here's another good Jerry.
Poor mucker, just 18. They must be hard up for manpower. Or else he volunteered, silly bastard. That's the fatal mistake. Never volunteer for nothing. Just as well it was him, though, and not one of our chaps. Yes, the only good Jerry, as they say, is your sock chum. Cheerio, you poor bastard.
Don't be late on parade when the Lord calls. Close order. Keep waiting for the angels. Keep listening for Reveille.
Well, scrive in the time, that is just for the dead. I guess, I mean, it's like a kind of corroganic Ukraine wrote in a short scrive here.
When I first got this book, it really smacked me in the face. Even if you don't understand everything he's meaning, there's something about the abstract quality of the words and the sentiments that gets to you.
When Hamish won the Somerset Maugham Award for his elegies for the dead in Cyrenaica, the eminent English socialist historian E.P. Thompson wrote to him congratulating him on having written the finest poetry of the Second World War, but reminding him of who he was writing for and saying that his songs and ballads were every bit as important as the poetry. And I think Hamish himself must have come to that realisation.
It was lovely when he got the Somerset Maugham Prize, but then he got that money and he was at that time in Northern Ireland and he backed a horse and it came in 66-1 or something. So he made, at that time, what was then a phenomenal amount of money, you know. I don't know if you want to call that magical, but it was certainly a very nice thing to happen to him, you know.
I first met Hamish just after he came out of the army, I think. So it must have been about 1947. And I met him in Hugh McDermid's house.
Well, Hugh McDermid was the poet who'd revolutionised Scottish poetry in the 1920s and 1930s. And of course, he was an extremely combative character and was continually at war with somebody or other.
Hugh McDermid, for Hamish Henderson, who was such a machine de chele. Haro smynioch o gyr o fardoch, ffiws o fardoch cogi ag Hamish, nach roa môr gylior, gyr o smynioch o gyr o fardoch ag hyn, torn y biarn o fardoch ag Hamish.
An egotism which produces poetry as magnificent as McDermott is its own justification. Nevertheless, I'm rather on the side of the collaborators there, and hope to stay among them.
Chaid am achar chéile is gás gan a chur mach a gréir mach tír mit síos ir tíol dúolach ir áren dúolach folk song a bíochat cár ani bárt bárt a cás de bhúna rút nach tigab Hamish rís idir.
Hugh McDermott would look at material, folk song material, and regard it as mostly a lot of very poor poetically, and it was much more of an elitist. Hamish was the opposite of elitism. He wanted a people's music to be celebrated, to give voice to the voiceless.
It was in between Warwick's Rye, I had to love with token. I hear my love, you're gone away, and no longer here. You mean
the first time I met Hamish, we fell out. I was 20 years old, ignorant, arrogant, ridiculously self-confident, and very much on the McDermott side of the divide, you know, the McDermott that said, why should the mutterings of illiterate goat herds interest me. whereas Hamish's view was he had to dig down beneath it and find the real Scotsman, the real roots of our character.
500 pounds if you marry me, a poor stranger.
Beginning now, she inscribed Hamish Peace Bardock, one was he in ancient enough. She the flighting of life and death. She bars the counting Croatian Croatian the back then piano. Napio, I guess I shouldn't either mark me corner at their death, life, and death.
Martin Ulug, Stree Itter, Ickle Legis, Stool, Hamisha Goose for Hamindus Ashkir. It a dart of her to Ferilla. Ah, a clear to Hilly. Ketterord, life. Qua life, the world is mine. Ketter Pishina own, Bivet own, I guess Bidunia, Shane, Sitiano, Sicumalora, Cumalbio. So Miss Mary Christina Hounds at the dear Gallagher in the spirit in the Behem. Qua life, the world is mine. The floors and trees, they're all my ain. I am the day and the sunshine. Qua life, the world is mine. Qua death, the world is mine. Your lugs are deaf, your een are blind, your floors maun dwine in my bitter wind. Qua death, the world is mine.
Qua life, the world is mine. The floors and the trees, they're all my own. I am the day and the sunshine. Qua life, the world is mine. Qua death, the world is mine. Wet stairs and reed gangs doon in pain. Bairns went in breed our mac and main. Qua death, the world is mine. Qua life, the world is mine. Your deedly work I ken it fine. There's mate on earth for ilka wane. Qua life, the world is mine.
Day the day, dum ti diddly dum ti dum ti day ti diddle day diddle day diddle day diddle diddle day dum ti diddle day dum ti diddly dum ti dum.
Certainly in Scottish literary history, the oral tradition has played always a tremendous part and continues to do so. One of the big pleasures in my life has been going among some of the travelling people, especially in the north, and seeing how lively this particular tradition is.
Dwi'n iawn gen fwyd y dŵr a ba rwy'n as ysgol dwi'n iawn ba cwyl wwy agos fan ysgol ar yn enem ond yn aachach ach nwbyr bod ar yn Hamish Henderson se fi crynioch yn ffog yn ysgol rwych agos yli gael eich dŵl bod yn nwbyr sy'n ychlwyndi.
My heart's been broken so many times.
Ysgolioolus na halapa, sef ar y fel y dhu afas, sgialoch yn ceol ys oran er y chlarag, agos er y gwmal, agos ta'n gan i ma cyfeil.
And my body is filled with woe and pain.
It was done at the right time because the people that Hamish was collecting from were the people who had grown up without the influence of the mass media. They had not been influenced at all by radio, television, film, They had grown up learning the songs when singing was a much larger part of culture than it is now.
In a barn or by the roadside.
Mae fe sgoliolus yn halapa, chafig sgiel, yn y hora, yn agos yn sgiel ac yn feig dyn di horsiachod. Agos mat, fasin Anna Macfisg o'r disarn, Tra mating na sapat, chunasin e ver cool art doroch lesbiach glan, ching tron rúch, gus na temtichin. Fasin ni shantan, kachin hakal hami lorog, weri, yer hain sharan, ach barudikin na piasha, der hanika faru roshin, agus, asad goa drish, As a vat, I have been a doy if I can a vicar agreeting.
Eddie Davis is not of Highland travelling stock, but now he's married to Essie Stewart, a Gaelic speaking traveller brought up within the family of the storyteller Ali Dowell.
Guncheco. Va Hamish Gomat Lou Ri Stuart Blair Gowry Nikersk Irfat Agus Hamish a Tukshin Shin Va Hamish a Tukshin Toy Behe Varka Va a Gaish Rishin Horan Sneskilkan Varka Agus Va in Horny Gavarosnahug Gavalug Agus Huchat Hain Agus Marahut Sheila Stuart Hamish gave us the confidence to believe in who we were.
He could connect and communicate with almost anybody, you know, and he could make people feel special, and it wasn't a false thing. Perhaps because when he was a small child, he didn't have the thing that most of us take for granted of having, you know, a family, a secure family life, and an identity as a son or as a brother or whatever. He derived great strength, I think, from the relationships that he developed throughout his life, and not just with us, but with lots and lots of people from lots of different walks of life. And those were, and that's, and what people responded to, of course, was his sincerity.
Oh, when the berry time comes around each year, Blair's population swelling, there is every kind of picker there and every
Has it harwad, and jolach harwad, a dool coro, and skialach and kutramachach, Der hoos ik schemes klaar uit mijn skielachen. Achter het mijn noorsin is het. Kroop ik een pisterach kro. Kreeg rood loach voor de baan.
The berry fields of Blair, lying in the vale of Strathmore between the Grampians and the Sidlaw Hills, are one of the great fruit growing areas of Britain. And every year these fields have provided an arena for the gathering of travelling people.
Try to please old MacIntyre, this is what he says. Oh, come along, you berry pickers, the berries are good today. Da 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 da. That's all.
Da 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 da. Some other verse?
No, that's all.
Do you know, who composed that one? Do you know?
My big sister.
The big sister, is she here now?
No.
Where is she now?
She made it up. She didn't name the day.
Did she? Oh, and that's fine. When did you make it up?
Hamish met his young German wife in Edinburgh at the top of Leith Walk, and they started an almost immediate passionate relationship. And Hamish took her up to the berry fields of Blair, and she became part of his life with the travellers and part of his recording culture at that time.
He was great because he always felt very relaxed and happy to be surrounded by the travellers, you know, because we had tents and they had tents and it was sort of campfires. It was all almost slightly romantic in the sort of sense, you know, sitting by your campfire, you know. Hamish and I first met in June 1956. I had come over to Britain with my sister, and we were walking along, talking German, of course, when suddenly a tall figure ahead of us stopped, turned round and said, "Höre ich die deutsche Sprache?" Which is quite poetic because, you know, normally we just say, "Sprechen Sie Deutsch?" or something like that. Anyway, didn't take long because Hamish started singing a German song and we joined in, and before we knew it, we were absolutely having a great time. For all man kum kurten me hey du adarti. For all man kum kurten me hey du adi.
For all man. This is the castle gate of Aberdeen and the weekly Friday market, where many years ago I came on the trail that led me to the discovery of Jeanie Robertson. Jeanie was a traveller, and many of the folk around here, though some mightn't like to admit it, belong to the ancient travelling clans of Scotland. Tell us, Jeanie, are there any McPhees in your own ancestry?
Yes.
There are.
Yeah.
Are they red McPhees or black McPhees?
My mother's grandmother was called Mary McPhee.
Oh, she was?
Yes.
And where was she from? Was she Pasha?
Well, Jeanie had this huge fund of classical ancient ballads, and she could sing the whole lot from beginning to end. She was a good singer as well. She was a lovely person. So for Hamish, the whole thing, all of a sudden, from us not knowing anything about it, all of a sudden it was all opened up to us.
When I came here in 1953, she wasn't by any means too pleased to see me. So I adopted cruel methods. I began singing to her on her own doorstep. And a slow smile spread over Jeanie's big face. And she said to me, "Come away inside and I'll sing you the right way of it."
For I was near and near enough and I the numbers saw there were 50,000.
I guess who had a che, Jeanie Robertson, a shine, I guess reached. New Jeanie who had a call and did a fashion to Hinniterns, the going of a land to be a larish. I guess who could kapar yatsen, I guess. Doing of a macher imel and who he acken you, and an alapa gund loch to me. Rinny barren in its rearing you. Who is Ursula? Shakabin and Erfiken Margunia Sura, who are at Ursula, through Hamish Henderson.
Well, Hamish, when you're going to Hamish, Buoy is culture in a halapa, and Shemishnyok. Who got the kitchen coron, no lochsaka hain. Gyro a ffeimol, agos gyro a ddia ag a sy'n nŵwch. Agos y tymwyn y dŵwch y cwdioch. Agos a mis mynd o gyro byw ei fôr ag e ddiddoch eith cwltr na halab eith ffad.
Im Jahr 1947 wurde das internationale Festival in Edinburgh gegründet. Wie viele Festivals, wie die Ruhrfestspiele oder also viele, viele Festivals rund in Europa nach dem Krieg, um eben Brücken zu bauen nach dem Krieg, kulturelle Brücken zu bauen. Aber ziemlich schnell hat man gesehen, es war ein sehr erfolgreiches Festival, aber es war eben Kultur, importierte Kultur und Kultur aus Großbritannien, die eben die E-Kultur war, die gehobene Kultur. Und einigen Leuten ging das ein bisschen gegen den Strich, dass da kein Platz war für die eigenständige, traditionelle Kultur Schottlands.
Es möchte ich Hamish gemacht, Fisch wie ein Kummel, mit einem Ruhe gerne lehit. Aber an der Neukehrt lehit zu hören, wer gewirr war, wer hohl stehe, the people's Kehle. Trinja Hupik Ekanaum, a gas, Gavi, and you, na Edinburgh Festival Fringe.
Hamish came to the committee with this idea that they would put up a concert of traditional Scottish folk song. and none of the committee knew what it was. Hamish had to explain, you know, that there were these people who had learned songs over generations, and he was going to bring them to Edinburgh and put them on. And it was the bringing of these people to the fore that was Hamish's legacy.
I think there's no doubt that the People's Festival, the alternative festival, if you like, was a precursor to the Fringe, gave birth to the Fringe.
So many things stemmed from it. I mean, I brought onto stages in successive years of the People's Festival, you know, some of the finest traditional singers in Scotland. People like Flora McNeil, the Gaelic singer from Barra.
Whatever the big festival, you know, the High Hedian Festival was going to do, we were going to create something else. And that, in fact, is what it all goes back to. In fact, I think you can trace a single line from that early period right on to now.
She's kilted her wee coatie's out her head, and she's followed him down to Stirling. But she's grown sae fou that she couldna boo, and he's left her in Dunfermline.
Bonnie lassie, I lie near ye, yes, bonnie lassie, I lie near ye.
She to change she on the Sandy Bell side of the island, but you have.
Of course, Hamish and I, we just lived in Sandy Bells. We actually slept above the pub, but we actually lived in it for about 5 years, and he would quite often perform in there and have a few drams, and he would get going, and it was great fun.
I guess I knew how land killed. I bought a whole house in Yak and had done a close kill on. I had a horse, she did a lamb and her shop, or a cow lamb, or her own, not you know. After Konyaki is ga, grow a fashk in the Skulgiolish and Halapa. I guess we have fashk in Olegon Legion for a mission Ukraine, how is Sean killed to her.
The Edinburgh folk scene wasn't recognised 30 years ago or 40 years ago. Hamish revived this thing. We wanted to revive it because it was good, because we thought the music was really good.
He wanted children, and of course that kind of certainly totally changed my life. Hamish, because I hadn't a clue what it meant having a baby in the house, you know, he probably had this rosy vision, oh yes, how wonderful, but that there was a lot of work involved, you know, he didn't know, and of course he had never had the opportunity to observe it, you know.
He didn't have a blueprint for family life. He didn't even know. He hadn't had a dad. He hadn't really had any meaningful degree. He had a mother. And so he didn't have the role models for being a parent. But more than that, I think also he just sort of, his inner child or whatever, was still quite present. And so the way he related to us, you know, that came across, you know. We took this long walk to Killiecrankie, and we'd taken one can of Pepsi with us. And he was telling us the story of the Green Man of Knowledge and how the Green Man of Knowledge could make things happen. You know, if you needed something, could make it, conjure it up. And we were walking and we got to the stream, and we thought we'd all just kind of splash some water in our faces. And then I'd been saying, oh, I'm really thirsty, I wish we had brought another can of Pepsi. And there was a can of chilled Pepsi in the stream. And my dad just said, Green Man of Knowledge, you know, and sort of muttered it under his breath, you know. Mm-hmm. And that was, I mean, and there were lots of stories like that.
Tim, what song should I sing? Of John McLean March, all right. Hi, Mark, did you see him as you come, Doon Bagorgi, a war?
I think of Hamish in politics, I think of culture. He wasn't interested in anything narrow. I remember him at a party singing an IRA song and then singing the sash. That was his politics.
John McLean was one of the lebenslangen Helden von Hamish Henderson. John McLean war ein Sozialist, der ins Gefängnis geworfen wurde, weil er sich geweigert hat, im Ersten Weltkrieg zu kämpfen. Zum 25. Jahrestag seines Todes schrieb Hamish den John McLean March, ein Lied über Glasgows Willkommen für John McLean, nachdem er aus dem Gefängnis entlassen wurde und wie ganz Glasgow für eine Weile den Atem anhält, weil John McLean zurück ist in Glasgow.
Your big heel and chuchter, get your pipes, mate, and march at the heads of the clan. Hello, Pat Malone, sure I knew you'd be here, so the red and the green lad will wear side by side. Garbles is his the day.
I always just love that line about the red and green will be worn together. Every aspect of Hamish's ability to reconcile differences, languages, cultures, bisexuality, Ulster, all of those things is in that, the red and the green, that counts for every doubleness, every Jekyll and Hyde, that he was able to say, no, those things can march together.
Great John McLean has come home.
Hallelujah, kun hoshe el big navarsist. Hamismunho gure gokinya sudanike, the tahosten wegehoos agusuhichu, hupuri. Ach, now the hachel michel toshes me maishit leoluge, sa tifishit leon's core on ocean, the notion kamal lodged. Agus chumerish, being a communist.
Personally, I think it was almost impossible to grow up in the 30s and not be left-wing, if you were honest at all.
Hamish was a Republican socialist, and he believed in an independent Scotland. And that never changed.
Jack Tre. Prima.
I suspect that he first came aware of his Scottishness with his relationship with the Scotties in the 51st Highland Division, and then he became aware of the power of working class culture through the partisans. And I think it was through these rural living people that must have taken him back to his own early years in Glenshee.
Lei, Signor Henderson, è soprattutto noto in Italia per aver tradotto Gramsci. Le interessa il letterato o il politico?
Tutte e due. Quando ero a Firenze ho parlato con partigiani, ho sentito per la prima volta il nome di Gramsci in Firenze durante la guerra, anche nel periodo quando la divisione potente dell'Arno era veramente in potere a Firenze. E poi ho avuto l'idea che questo sarebbe un grande filosofo senza aver letto niente di lui. Loro m'hanno detto un grande pensatore. E poi dopo la guerra, quando lavoravo in Irlanda, Amleto Micozzi, un amico mio che ha fatto qua a Roma, mi ha mandato le lettere dal carcere quando sono apparse. E io in una notte ho letto questo libro, no, tutta la notte, e poi ho cominciato a tradurlo.
Gramsci was a Sardinian-born socialist philosopher. Had he lived longer, because he died in Mussolini's jails when he's still in his 30s, he would have given a more human face to Marxism. He had a much more organic view, I think, of humanity.
Era intorno al 1950 che Hamish ha ricevuto il foglio di via per abbandonare l'Italia. Lui stava traducendo le lettere dal carcere di Antonio Gramsci, la cui copia la ricevette nel 1946, l'anno della pubblicazione. Quando ricevette appunto il foglio di espulsione, all'epoca Hamish ricordava che c'era la guerra fredda, era considerato una spia comunista.
Hamish had a reputation, and Hamish found himself, in a sense, in a mild sense, blacklisted by the BBC.
The fact that Clee in the politics when Hamish was in the cutter in the nation, I guess Haro Shesu, I can now met a senda Shorseberg. I guess Erskashin, Kay Hermes, Bobby Trifskul, Er Radio in Aramurin Telly, Stochanik in Hoshoko, Fat Imipliona, had to her two Hamish. Fasker mikrofoner som ringer BBC och så tar man det kolla för sig.
Koju va BBC omavasoch na ögi. Agus a kainem för a henik in sjugo gud chonicha di för annan hajast annan nation va art as a BBC agus hudadish as a viola. We'll get you for something one of these days, Henderson.
Ach, wa Hamish, kujach gefarach gein, wa Lord Rees kaun wa BBC egen laum, agus garo isen agus duni yenig horsusen, fatten lei, datse bi yenig isen hiunskere Marxist gemo.
BBC Television had an idea to put out a television show featuring folk music called The Hootenanny Show. Hamish requested that some of the more traditional singers like Jeannie Robertson and Jimmy McBeath be given a hearing. So Jeannie Robertson was invited onto the programme. And the whole effect, I think, of the Hootenanny Show revealed that Scotland to the bosses in London that they had no idea existed. I mean, the national fervour that the Hootenanny Show raised was enormous. As for Hamish, he never appeared on the show. It was unlikely that he would have been asked to sing or come on and comment. And it was basically a show for, can I dare say it, for young people.
Hey!
The folk song revival went through a series of phases of changes in musical taste, were encouraged by youth who wanted something different from their parents and grandparents.
Three cross sat upon a wall, sat upon a wall.
And then there was a split into ethnic and commercial, or as the detractors on either side said, the tartan cowboys and the finger in the ear mob, was how it was described by outside observers, and it got quite bitter at times. So there were various strands to this folk revival.
All learned men who use the pen have wrote you praises high. That sweet gin from Ireland, green distilled from wheat and rye. Throw away your pills, it'll cure all ills, be pagan.
Hamish, in a sense, was the pivot for the folk revival. Whatever anyone else says, the final resource and the final arbiter of whether the music was fit for publishing or producing or performing went back to Hamish. And whilst he was always very kind and very generous in his praise for young groups coming up, he didn't quite have an intolerance, but I think he had divided views on the validity of the music and the interpretations.
Lassie with a yellow coatie, would you want a muirland jockey?
Although the commercial side, the paying of singers, the turning of a number of fairly gifted young amateurs into paid prima donnas, although this to a certain extent may have been inevitable, it's something I think that in the long run we will have to fight. Otherwise, what you have is not so much a revival as a sort of plastic recreation.
We're carrying on a tradition, or we like to think we're carrying on a tradition, or several traditions passed down by some of the old folk singers, the traditional singers. Basically, our job, I think, is to sing and to entertain people, and that was the job of folk singers and has been the job of folk singers for hundreds and hundreds of years. As simple as that, I think.
Although he resented the commercialization of the music, he could see, he did come to see the value of that and said so, the value of getting the stuff out on television.
I received a call from Hamish in the summer of 64, and he had written a song about Mandela and the Rivonia trials. And he asked us if we would come over to the School of Scottish Studies and record it for him, which we did.
They have sentenced the men of Rivonia, the comrades of Nelson Mandela.
The tune that I set my Mandela song to was a tune coming out of the Spanish Civil War. It seemed to me to link well. They have sentenced the men of Rivonia, rumbala, 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 the comrades of Nelson Mandela, rumbala, rumbala, rumbala. He is buried alive on an island, free Mandela.
I think that, Hamish saw how important folk song was in every country, how it protested against the things that he felt were unjust. That inspired him to do what he did here.
Hamish war lebenslange ein hat Apartheid gehasst. Das geht wiederum auf seine Kriegserfahrungen zurück. In Afrika waren afrikanische Chors dabei, in El Alamein und im Krieg. Und die afrikanischen Chors wurden genauso behandelt wie die anderen natürlich auch. Im Krieg gab es diese Unterschiede nicht. Und er hat gesagt, diese Unterschiede soll es auch im Frieden nicht geben. Und als er darüber informiert war, wie in Südafrika die Rassentrennung funktioniert, hat er dagegen rebelliert von den späten 40er Jahren an.
Hamish was like that. I mean, he hated all kinds of injustice. He really did. And that South African thing he was passionate about.
I mean, optimism is one thing and hope is another. Mm-hmm. But for this hero and martyr, for that is in fact what he was and is, to have maintained his position over all those years in prison and to have emerged. I mean, people used to say, where were you when J.F. Kennedy was assassinated? Yeah. Who cares? But where were you when Nelson Mandela emerged from prison, looking elegant and self-possessed? Obviously, he's also a politician.
Sure.
And must act as a politician, otherwise he won't survive.
Yes, yes. Yeah.
He had an ambition for the old-fashioned virtues of society, of which marriage is one. But at the same time, he could not lose his poetry for a wife. He could not leave his political activism for a wife. And without money, without servants, that becomes a problem, and it became a problem with them.
Well, what basically made me decide that we should live apart, certainly Hamish clearly needed space because his whole life was slightly different from what you might call a sort of, you know, very structured. So he needed the space, and obviously family life wasn't the best thing for that. I mean, you know, it did interfere with Hamish's ideas. And of course, he'd also been very, very free until he was nearly 40 when we got married, you know.
When we moved across to my mum's flat, the flat was quite small, so I actually moved back across and lived in my dad's flat in number 20. So I think he got a hell of a lot of family life with us, but equally he had very much his own life and his own things that he wanted to pursue.
I didn't want a divorce, but I thought it would be easier all round. there was no quarrel, or we weren't at daggers drawn. Every Sunday he came and had a lunch meal and then another meal in the evening, and it was really great.
Chico va isge behe joch va sin roin heimish. Agus me twali si gallo gira glanye ve gestram na laid. Ach voam ko ach rohrich bi fioinele chi in gan na vort agus bi glanye is chi glanye. Agus ket nach ro heimish feinach ere hon. Sin mar hanna gael, agus na gael gwydio, sin mar hanna halapis, hanyl sgocht agin, ec y fawrt mar sio, agus nil i wofas am magwyn.
I think Hamish was a, you know, quite a formidable drinker, and he left me standing, or falling over actually, on quite a few occasions, and yes, it was part of his whole kind of conviviality.
He did drink a lot, but it was fuel for the social and cultural life that he lived. It was so much part of the song, the music, the conversation that he lived for.
Hamish's relationship to drink didn't affect his artistic or intellectual life at all. People's attitudes to Hamish's relationship with drink tells me more about their morality than Hamish Henderson's. I always used to think that Hamish used to drink like a squaddy.
Now, we'll have a small break.
Ha ha, it's a good one, Kelly was to be at Hamish, game at the final coming king of the Goth and a rotten game.
I would like to introduce Hamish, who's already done a major. I think Hamish came from a family that drank on both sides. His mother drank, certainly his father, James Scott, drank.
Well, Hamish was, as generally known, an illegitimate son. And there were many speculations as to his paternity.
Ek yw nawn co yw, dat yr a am y blar gyrdd, gyr e trafod yr diolchwadur, yr o Seamus Scott, gyr hysyn y gahar dy Hamish Henderson. Agus Seamus, James on the Bible, Scott, Henderson and Henem Gleach Mac Aganato with Hamish Henderson.
They did talk about the mother and the grandmother, you know.
He talked about distant people, like he talked about this Sir Lachlan Gunn, remember the
ancestors from God knows
yeah,
you
from
know
several
how many
centuries.
Had, yes, yes, that he did, but I mean that was again that was just to know.
He never mentioned his father, did he?
Yeah. No.
It's true.
No.
I never asked him about his father. I knew some of the stories about it. I guess I subscribed to the most famous one, that he was the illegitimate son of the Duke, that the strange mixture of the peasant and the aristocrat, that he'd somehow managed to meld together, would have made perfect sense with that story. So there was a mythic aspect.
Well, I heard in about 1970 that Hamish was possibly the son of the 8th Duke of Atholl. I'd more or less forgotten about this until I went to work as a guide in Blair Castle and was confronted with a photograph of the 8th Duke of Atholl. I thought I was looking at Hamish Henderson for a second.
And he came to get a call from Suisco, going to get Blair Ahal. Blion yn ei am ystod chwch yna. Agus se, a mw a fasoch ma hafa sy'n adr yn ys ac yn chalwm mi gweld yn elwys diach yn ard i chat sef awn. Agus fe hwys, se rhwm gorau mi fi gac ymwneud, rhwm môr al yn
gynnach fôr y cwad yma chyd byn y fragu. Ys fi gliori chi'n ac yma gwni iddo y fantl pys. Hwyl o siosio lior. Ac ys hyrwchydd gyro lior am ysgrif tegyn y chlonion ac y nwch gydwg. Ac ys sy'n lior y hyr. Hymys, ac ys chymys sŵs yma dyn ni'n fasiol y cwp yn tu. Ac ys o, na chyr sio mi erfaliwch. Ond y liabu fôr bras y cwad yma chai benni fragu. Ac ys y lefych lior pwyr mahar. One morning he phoned, of course, to my flat and said, oh, something really strange has happened today. And I said, oh, what is it? Oh, I've got a letter from Mrs. Thatcher's office in number 10, and they're wanting to award me the OBE. So I said, oh, I'll come across and have a look, you know. And an hour later, you know, I went across, and Hamish was sitting in the kitchen, his chair, sort of slightly sort of angry and kind of not very pleased. And I said, so where's it? Oh, I've torn it and flushed it down the toilet.
Floret silva undique, the lily, the rose I lay. Telltale leaves on the elm tree bole, Greekies root for a Sabbath stroll. Tivanek from that padded sheens, cowboy t-shirts and booters jeans.
When I first knew Hamish, I used to go and get him a roll at the local deli before I ever edited him. Just was helping look after him. And that story I often tell is, and the most treasured memory I have of Hamish is, because he had these knackered hips, he couldn't have a bath. So he needed help and he would kneel in it. And one day he said to me, Ick, I've had enough, I want to lie down in the bath. It was quite difficult because he was a big man and it meant having to help him out. And he lay back there relaxing and I sat on the loo. And then he recited the whole of Rilke's 10th elegy to me in German from memory. I didn't understand a word, but it was one of the most privileged moments of my life. There were tears flooding down his cheeks.
Well, I mean, Hamish had his wife, Katzel, and his daughters, you know, and that was, on one hand, his public persona. But, of course, you know, in the mid-70s, Katzel lived on one end of the street and Hamish lived on the other. And there's no two ways about it that Hamish was bisexual.
I think as a chlanian ag Hamish to us, but do ni graag yn sgarad. Chan chad y sgarad mwys o'n nidr. Chai at y gyddoch, chai cedsil y gyddoch yn y flat, gyddoch di hwf. Ach fe gwrdd as i ei ddiaf. Fe gad cwlwg ac y biog y chwlw siach goyn. We got Lanian, we got Yedraka Kolo, Gaspideva Tachert, Gatachroa, the Fidokas and Nid Dachi, Haroskarga, the dear.
For Hamish, it was a very natural part of life. Sex is not something we speak about, but for Hamish, he didn't go out of his way to speak about it, but if it came into the conversation, that was it. And he wasn't embarrassed or awkward.
In 1938, when Hamish was a schoolboy at Dulwich, he went to Paris and he stayed in a youth hostel and he met a fair-haired, rather beautiful boy who came from Nancy. And he had come to sell himself as a homosexual at the World Fair. And he and Hamish established a kind of cultural singing and presumably a sexual relationship.
girl like Hamish then who will have had feathers ballin, do her scallus as boy harago jiffer.
The three words, love. Love is the only God that I believe in. The Holy Bible says God is love. God is really love. Love casts out hate. Love gets rid of all fears. Love washes all clean. Love forgives all debts. Love overcomes all errors and excuses and pardons and understands the reason why the mistake, the error was made. Love heals all. Love asks rather for you to tell its forces what to do and where to go and how to build up your planet here by the blueprint plan of your heart's desire.
Your love commands must ever be the direct opposite of war's crazy, baseless hatreds. Peace. Peace. Sweet peace must be the song. I can't read this.
Peace. Peace. Sweet peace must be the song on your tongue tip. Peace is love. Love is peace. Your love commands must for all eternity be your peace command.
Hamish Shachat blíon chun mé dhéirigh na céir thom ar an éigin. Agus bhí mé hín dulas deach trí nó céir tuas gach seachan. Cha raibh furas na gá idir, cha raibh siúil bha sin duribh gá agus bha an gcónaí bic an tréin. Ach gach lá, có bha rí tuv eliebi nio sa tse herile a ketzel.
For my name is Jock Stewart, I'm a canny gunman, but a roving young fella I have been.
Seeing him in the home was not like seeing him how he used to be, because obviously he was in his prime, if you like. He was a very vigorous presence and, you know, a great intellect and a great company. And in the home, you could tell that he, you know, that was, if you like, ebbing away a bit. But I suppose the thing that didn't ebb away was the fact that he was always pleased to see us.
Come fill up your glasses of brandy and wine.
Occasionally, he would be a little bit confused, you know, and he would say to me, oh, this is a lovely hotel. Or he thought it was the university staff club. Because he had been in homes when he was a child and a young adult. It was almost, you know, it didn't seem to him, I don't think it seemed too bad to him, you know. And he certainly never, ever complained or anything, you know.
I have acres of land.
I remember going to the home in my bee truck. I have an old Volkswagen caddy van in which I carry my beehives. And I got Hamish into it, and we put a Zimmer frame and a blanket and so on, and we drove off. We drove up to Blairgowrie. We drove to Glenshee, where he was as a boy. And every place we went brought memories and poems and songs to mind.
So be easy and free when you're drinking.
When Janet was getting married in 2000, and with the help of my sister, we actually took Hamish to France because they were getting married in France. And that was really very nice.
Of brandy and wine. Whatever it costs.
But I was very glad he was with us because he died the following year, so that was really great. We were able to do that.
man who's done.
And then I went back to see him again, and then I needed to say goodbye to him. And I didn't know what to say. But I rose to give him a kiss. And as I did, I thought of something that a travelling man, James Stewart from Aberdeen, had told me on the phone. He said, Tim, tell Hamish that all the travellers are thinking of him. All the travellers are out for him. And so I whispered that to Hamish as I said goodbye. And then I went to the door and looked back. And Hamish looked at me as I closed the door and seemed to will me on to something. What it was, I do not know.
So be easy and free when you're drinking with me. I'm a man who's done meet every day.
The finest folklorist in Scotland is a professor at Edinburgh named Hamish Henderson. And besides being a collector of ballads, he's also a fine poet. Hamish loves Scotland as much as he loves life itself. And yet he knows very well that the bagpipes and kilts went skirling through Africa and India and other parts of the world, and people hated the sound of Scotland the Brave. So he wrote this song with all that in mind. Rach the wind thro the clear days dawin, blows the clouds heels the gallery o'er the bay. But there's ne'er nor a wind blowin through the great land o' the wild
is the best song of any to come out of the folk revival at any time.
So come on ye, and in with freedom, never
be. Sean Sousa, I can hold it in you, never a hain. I guess Sousa, I can hold it do he, guy pain. She did not in your first sculpture, so I shall give me Sousa better. I can hold it in you, I guess I can hold it to you.
When the clay meets whisperings and scrambling, all the roses and gins will turn to blue.
Freedom Camellia tries to express the feeling that human beings everywhere should be united. And if I bring it in to express a Scottish sentiment, it's because Scotland has got a long tradition of this, from the 18th century, from Robert Burns onwards. This is part of my life. I've enjoyed this to an extent that I can't tell you, you know. I don't want to exaggerate, but that's it.
Lands with Harry, Wilka, Scotland, the brave, black and white in Glivermary, mark the vile barracks of the maesters fair.
When the rain says rings and spring bird, are the hoes that begins to take and the black lad beyond Nyanga, things the fell gathers or the bargers. So come on, ye at him with freedom, never heed what the queen.
Kate ní Claud scartóir de turas go cuid de na cearnaí an álainn na chéilcha anaitis na hélanan iniar. Bí caniach ag rís sin a chéan le scéalach an íontach mi na háitichan ar a bhlí go mad déal os ceann agus fonisce. Mian na maidin mara, in aich ag léiris deoch ar BBC Awapa.